find their seats. We'll be starting with King Quick moment. If I could just get everyone's attention, I just have a quick few announcements. If I could just get everyone's attention, I have a quick few announcements.
Can we have everyone's attention, please? We're gonna start soon.
So we have a backdrop in the left corner over there. So there's like a paper and pen so you can write your wishes there just to make the backdrop look a lot nicer. Second, you guys should have all received a brochure when you came in. Keep that with you at all times because you're going to need that to vote later on. We'll talk more about that later on. And third, if you're in Northeast BSA and you didn't get your after party ticket, go to Megan. Oh, she's on the left right here. Go to Megan, she has like 10 tickets, so if you didn't get it, just go to her. Alright, welcome ladies and gentlemen to Miss Asia 2019. My name is Evan.
And my name is Michelle, and we'll be your MCs for the night.
For those of you who have come to our previous Miss Asias, we want to welcome you back and thank you for coming again. And for those of you that are here for the first time, we want to welcome you, and we hope that you look forward to what we have in store for you tonight.
And tonight we have six lovely contestants competing to be crowned the next Miss Asia. But before we begin, we would like to do a special shout out for our judges tonight.
So please, give a warm round of applause as we introduce the first judge. The current Northeast BSA President, Norman Chuck.
Next, we have the Vice President of the Multicultural Affairs, Khalil James.
Lastly, we have a former Binghamton BSA president and Binghamton alum, Kenny Blondo. We also want to welcome and thank the ASU subgroups here today, as well as the outside BSA organizations. So let's start the roll call with ASU. BSA, where's the group BSA?
Stony Brook BSA?
SJUVSA. Binghamton, you just say.
Hey, yo, Binghamton!
Please turn your attention towards the screen on the right. So you guys gotta bring your necks. Sharon. Three more. guys know how this works. There's six chairs, 70 of you guys. The ties is worth it. Let's just start the music. Yo, Sonny, the music. So we'll have that to give out for mini games. So let's do one. I think all the contestants are ready, but thank you for playing. Congratulations. Let's give them a round of applause. Yeah, well, I heard that they traveled back to their home countries.
Really? That quick? Oh, look! They're arriving in their traditional clothing!
Introducing the first contestant of the cultural walk, we have Miss Myanmar, Irene Kayan.
Thank you. Next up, we have this video, Shimona Larry.
Thank you.
hands together for Miss India, Shimona Lahiri.
Thank you.
by Michelle Shin.
Next up, we have Miss Myanmar, Betty.
The dog is gonna do it later on. $12.
That's
the
best
spot,
though. Okay. So, first of all, hi.
Hi!
I have never played guitar and sang in public, so I'm very nervous. I
ਜਦੋਂ ਤੁਰਦੀ ਸਿਤਾਰਾ ਵਾਲੇ ਖਾਵੇ ਮੋਰਨੀ ਜੀ ਤੁਰ ਕੁੜੀਏ ਤੁਰ ਕੁੜੀਏ ਹੁਣ ਮੁੰਡਿਆਂ ਨੂੰ ਹੋਸ਼ ਕਿੱਥੋਂ ਆਵੇ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਗਿਣੀ ਦੀ ਅੱਗ ਵਾਲੀਏ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਗਿਣੀ ਦੀ ਅੱਗ ਵਾਲੀਏ
with Burmese people because I never got to see them around. So I thought that because there's not that that much representation that I should come up and show that Burma is a country and that we should recognize it a little more due to its beautiful culture as well as all the other cultures here. And yeah, I think that being Miss Asia is a representation of everything that, all the hard work and all the prosperity that we strive for in life that happens to, you know, be one of our life goals. And I think that being Miss Asia is something that can help us become just help us become in connecting with their culture.
Thank you. Let's give you a round of applause.
Why do you want to be Miss Asia?
Well, for starters, I'm so, so proud to be Bengali. It's like such an amazing thing in my life. And it's important to me because it's given me so much to love about myself, so much to appreciate about my identity, and so much to share with all of you. And I think being Miss Asia is important because I want to be one of those people that represents the underrepresented Bengali community, both at Binghamton, in politics, in our everyday life. And, you know, obviously, like, I'm only one out of a million in America, but one person can make a big difference. And I think that, like, what's important is that all of us being here shows all of you that Asians don't come in one shape, size, or color. We come in intelligent, talented human beings.
All right, Miss Philippines, the same question. Why do you want to be Miss Asia?
First of all, I just want to say thank you all for showing up tonight and giving all of us a chance to be here to show us, show you guys our heritage and everything like that. So the reason why I want to be Miss Asia is because I actually grew up here in Binghamton, New York, and I went to high school, but like all I grew up here, and I was mostly surrounded, my peers were all white individuals, so I felt as though that I was kind of secluded from other people, and I wanted to kind of fit in with what the norm was. But when I would come home, like my family would surround me with love and support, and we would share traditional values at home at all the time. And I remember one thing in fifth grade when I brought my snacks into school. I don't know if you're Filipino or not, but if you ever had corn egg, that's like one of the greatest snacks ever. And it has a really strong scent, so when I brought it out, everyone was like, what is that? And ever since then, I would kind of just hid my snack in my lunch. But then growing up, going through high school and everything, my family built a Filipino community around here. And I actually started bringing these, my snacks, my food, like everything to school and showing people what it's like to be Filipino. And I just want everyone to feel empowered, no matter what their heritage is, their culture, their background, that they should be proud of who they are and that they should be able to showcase it without feeling scared or anything like that at all. So by me being Miss Asia, I want to be able to empower all of you guys to show off your culture, show your heritage, and to not be afraid of anything like that because we're all unique. Yeah, when we all come together, it's all just a great time. It's all beautiful when all the cultures are being shared and everything is just, you know, being appreciated and loved.
Hello, Miss India. Why do you want to be Miss Asia?
You know, I really think that everybody here has done such a good job of representing their country, and I think everybody, you know, they deserve Miss Asia. The reason why I would want to be Miss Asia is because, you know, India is a country that's so close to my heart. I grew up in America. I didn't grow up in India, but I was born there. I've never felt like I fit in when I was younger. As an Indian, like, I obviously had many, I was obviously like surrounded by many, many, you know, people who weren't part of my culture, especially coming from like a place like Poughkeepsie. My entire thing about being Miss Asia is that I really want to create a safe space for people to appreciate their own cultures, because I think that's an amazing thing. Being proud of your own culture is so, so important because it creates your identity, it creates who you are. So this is something that, you know, like I feel like everybody should embrace, and I want to, you know, set a way kind of for people to just embrace who they are. And that's why I'm on Miss Asia. Thank you.
All right, Miss Chan, the same question. Why do you want to be Miss Asia?
Last year, I was actually one of the attendees in the audience right now. I watched Miss Asia because my friend Michelle, the MC, was Miss Vietnam. And at first, I thought it was just a typical beauty pageant. It was sponsored by an organization that was probably big-headed and something like that. But then once I actually attended the pageant, I learned that cultures can stand in solidarity against all of these different types of oppression. I've learned that we can embrace our different cultures no matter how different it may be. For instance, Chinese and Korean cultures may be a bit more traditional and standard, whereas Indian and Bangladeshi cultures are more fiery and spicy. I think that Miss Asia is a very great example and a very great way to spread exposure and knowledge of how different cultures work together to become a better united world. And same thing, when I came into college, I was actually very shy. I didn't really want to do anything, I just wanted to stay in my bed. But then seeing Miss Asia made me empowered, made me emboldened, and I really wanted to try and promote the message that there's a spot for everyone and we can all be united, even if we are different. Thank you.
And last but not least, Miss Korea. Why do you want to be Miss Asia?
So partially for the same reason. One, because I did attend Miss Asia last year, and let me say, the show was bomb. But secondly, it's just because, like, I am Korean. I know to most, like, I may not look Korean, but I promise I am. It's something that I take a lot of pride in. Originally as a child, like, I grew up in a very predominantly white neighborhood, and it was very difficult because I felt very excluded and very shunned. But then you come to somewhere like Binghamton, where we embrace so many different cultures, and Miss Asia is a great way to showcase that. And even though Korea is such a small culture, or such a small country, most people don't know that Korea, for one, was a third world country for decades, actually. But with that, like, I take a lot of pride in my culture once again, just because you see this third world country start booming into this economic powerhouse as well. Like, I know a lot of people know K-pop, I know a lot of people know our expensive 10K skin routines, but I promise we're a lot more than that. We're a country that comes from struggle and that grew into something that was a lot greater. And because of that, like, I'm proud, and like, as a Korean, I just really hope that other people will be able to appreciate our culture as well.
All right, thank you, contestants. Hopefully the answers helped to narrow down the search for this year's Miss Asia. But now we'll be moving into a time of intermission.
But please, don't get out of your seats yet. We have a few announcements. DSI is selling after party tickets at the table, so if you're still interested in going, cop your tickets.
All right, next, as I mentioned before, in your brochures, if you turn to page somewhere, you'll find, like, where you can vote for your crowd favorite and favorite Halloween costume. So we'll be passing pens around, and make sure that you get your votes in. As soon as you do that, you can rip that off out of the page, and some of our e-board members will be going around collecting the votes in baskets.
And also, don't forget, hold on to your raffle tickets, because right after intermission, we are raffling off a fire stick and an Echo Dot.
Alright, so make sure you get your votes in and hold on to your raffle tickets. Again, DSI's vote is selling their after party tickets at the check-in table. After you're done, you guys can go to the restroom, you guys can take pictures. We'll see everyone in 15 minutes. Thank you. Get your raffle tickets ready. If we call you up, just come up and we'll give you the fire stick.
Can we get a drum roll, please?
So we have ticket 2256405.
Fire stick,
repeat it.
2256405.
We have a winner. Congratulations.
I'll just check it out. Okay, congratulations. Yeah, fire stick right there. All right, thank you. All right, the next.
Oh yeah, so now we're raffling off the Echo Dot. Another drum roll, please.
number 226655. Anyone?
We have a winner. Let's give her a round of applause. All right, it's a match. Okay, thank you, Nia and Anita. Let's just give them another round of applause.
All right, so next, we will be revealing the top three contestants voted by our judges. And they'll be moving on to a Q&A session between the top, we'll be moving on to a Q&A session for our three contestants, and those questions are by our judges themselves.
All right, so for this final round, we would like to invite our first contestant among the top three to the stage. And that is, drum roll please. Miss India.
Surpassing that challenge. Yeah.
you'll be asked, answering the same questions. You remember the question?
Yeah, my question again is, what is the biggest challenge you face in your life? And what steps did you take in order to address that challenge?
So I have one right off the top of the bat. I'm only half Bengali, so I'm only half Asian. And that's been a really big struggle for me my entire life, just because I'm really disconnected from my other half, which is Egyptian. He left a long time ago, my dad, and it's been my mom since, you know, like as long as I know. And she's taught me everything that I know about Bengali. She's taught me how to speak Bengali. She's taught me to appreciate my culture. She's taught me to accept my identity. And I'm slowly beginning to do all of that, but I can't help but feel like sometimes I don't fit in because I'm only half Asian. And I know a lot of people here might go through the same problems. And what I think we can do as, you know, a whole team, you know, because we're all united in one way or another, as a team, we can make sure that we remind each other that you don't have to be 100% Asian to be Asian. There's no definition of Asian. Asian comes in so many different, like I said earlier, so many different sizes, so many different colors, so many different people. And I think it's important for us to understand that even if we're not 100% Asian on the outside, it's how much we love and appreciate our culture that makes us Asian. Being proud of being Asian is what makes us Asian. So, yeah. I mean,
Alright, Miss Philippines, you'll be answering the same question. Kenny, can you repeat it for her, please?
Sure thing. My question is, what is the biggest challenge you face in your life? And what steps did you take in order to address that challenge?
So, like the other girls here, growing up, identity was always an issue for me since I was always surrounded by a white majority. And also being Filipino, some people like don't even consider it Asian, considering it is in Asia. And I've heard, oh, you're not Asian enough to be in the Asian community. Oh, you're not American enough to be in the American community. And that kind of leads you at a tie. And that just kind of growing up has just been a knot just in my stomach all the time. But growing up here as a Filipino-American, I've learned to embrace both sides, to bring both of those sides together, because it's not picking one or the other. It's picking the best values from each and embodying that in yourself. And over time, I've just kind of brought that in me. I brought that energy in me. And especially through my family, they always reminded me, like, Victoria, even though you were here in America, even though you are disconnected from your family in the Philippines, like, we will always be there for you, we will always stand for you. So I want to just remind everyone that if you yourself are going through something like this, where you don't know if you fit in one place or another, that you know truly who you are inside, and you just have to embody that in yourself, and just bring that light out. Because once you do that, you will feel so much better embracing your culture and your heritage and things like that. And that's how I overcame my difficulties, is just not trying to pick one or the other. It's bringing them together. And thank you.
All right, we'll be moving on to Norman's question now.
How y'all doing today? So, first of all, my man Kenny's single. And my question is, so as you know, in today's political atmosphere, cultural awareness has decreasing growth. What is one thing you can do to increase the understanding of your culture, not just in your community, but also outside of it?
All right, we're gonna start with Miss Philippines. All right, so once again, my family actually here gathered a community of Filipinos. They established their own club. They're called the Filipino American Association of Binghamton. And I grew up with that, and that's what also always kept my culture in me, is seeing my titos and my titas, all of us gathering for holidays and celebrations. And as I said before, when I was younger, I really couldn't really bring that into my school setting. But throughout high school and everything, I introduced my friends to lumpia. I introduced them to food and the home cooking, and they really enjoyed that. And one way was that bringing it into my community is that my family and their organizations likes to showcase it with annual Christmas parties, traditional Filipino parties, and things like that. And I came into Binghamton knowing that there was a Filipino club here. Both of my siblings participated in it, and they said they loved it. And through this club, it's empowered me even more that I want to spread my culture. I'm the educational chair, so I just love spreading things about the Philippines and things like that. Like, in today's like climate, people can be very ignorant, and the one way to combat that is just to educate. You have to start a conversation in order for people to start listening. Like, you can't just push everything away. When you bring something into light, that's when people start seeing it. You can't stop talking about something. You have to keep going, and that's how you spread the word and the message. You can't give up, is what I'm saying. You can't, like, be held back. You just have to go full force forward. Show everyone your culture, your heritage, your everything, because the hesitation is what's gonna put it back in the dark. So I believe that once you start the conversation, bring the light out, that's one way you can spread the culture and within the community and even without the world. Thank you.
All right, next up, Mrs. Neal will take that question. So if you could repeat it, please.
Of course. As you know, in today's political atmosphere, cultural awareness has decreased in growth. What is one thing you can do to increase the understanding of your culture, not just in your community, but also outside of it?
So actually, many people don't know this about me, but I'm also Bengali, and I'm saying that because there's a huge part of India that is full Bengali, and I'm part of that. It's West Bengal, and so being Indian is so different around the country, and I'm so proud to be Bengali because of that. And one thing that I've, you know, ever since, you know, last year, we've started this club called the Bengali Student Association. I'm on the e-book for that, and we're, you know, it's a new Ontario club, and we're so excited to spread not only Bengali culture but also Indian culture as well, because they're both very interconnected. And so this is something that not many people know. This is something that I want to embody especially. And yeah, that's kind of what I'm doing. Yeah.
Norman, can you repeat it for her, please?
Of course. Wait, Kenny, are you still single?
Yeah.
So, he's still single, by the way. But, anyway, as you know, in today's political atmosphere, culture awareness has decreased growth. What is one thing you can do to increase the understanding of your culture, not just in your community, but also outside of it?
So I think one of the most important things that we learn in university and in college is that conversation and discourse is very important. As young adults, we know that all of us have differing opinions, and the only way to kind of come to some kind of compromise is if we're all talking about it with each other in an intelligent manner, weighing all sides, understanding that all of us come from different backgrounds and different ethnicities, and we all have different opinions and different religions, and it's definitely key to understand that. I mean, in addition to being Bengali, I am also Muslim, so I am, you know, kind of two minorities at once, and it's difficult to kind of manage my way through life with, you know, trying to ignore all those stereotypes and all the news about Muslims in the media and what, you know, trying to portray the exact opposite. I come from one of the poorest villages in Bangladesh. I grew up there. I came here when I was 5. And I've done so much since then. And I want people to know that, like, you don't know what background people came from. And if you only give yourself a chance to meet new people and go to cultural organizations and get-togethers like this one, where everyone in the audience is, you know, from a completely different background, completely different culture, and we're here all together celebrating all of us who are here representing Asian. And so just, you know, like, the most important thing for us to do is just be fair to one another and understand that, like, if you were in that person's position, you don't know what you'd be doing, you don't know where you'd be. And it's so important to just be, like, selfless and understand that, like, we're all in this together, you know?
Finally, we'll be moving on to our last question. This will be taken by Miss Bangladesh first, and then Miss Philippines, and finally Miss India. But Khalil, could you please ask your question?
Okay, this is just a general statement. Kenny is still single. No, but first and foremost, I want to thank you all for, like, allowing me to participate tonight. This question might be a little heavy, but it's really gonna let me kind of see the character that you all have. So one of the things that you all mentioned is the pride you feel from your individual cultures. And as someone like myself who believes in representation, give me an example of a direct impact you have had, and if you can, recognize a life that you have changed. That was kind of long, I know.
No, so. It's okay, I understand the question.
Thank you.
When I was younger, not now, because I've grown older and I've, you know, become more busy with school and I'm far away from home, but when I was younger, I have two younger brothers. So me and my younger brothers, we used to be a part of this program at our local mosque, and it was for kids who came from Bangladesh as immigrants and needed help reading. And we were one of the first few kids there who went to very good middle schools, but we were all part of ESL programs. And as we learned more English in those ESL programs, we used our perseverance and our talent and everything that we've learned to teach other students who came from Bangladesh and other countries to speak Bengali, and in addition to that, to read Arabic, which is what something that we all learned how to do together. And I think the impact that I had on these students is, you know, like, you can come from nothing, but you can make it to something so big if you just keep pushing and keep asking for help and keep looking for resources. You know, you can do it.
Cleo,
can you please repeat the question for her?
All right. So, one of the things you all have mentioned is the pride you feel from your individual culture. As someone who believes in representation himself, I would ask you to give me an example of the direct impact you have had, and if you can, recognize a life that you have changed.
So, growing up in this area, as you all have heard for the millionth time tonight, I was kind of lost in touch with my culture, but my family is the people who brought it back. And when you're Filipino, everyone is family, no matter who they are. So I basically have, she's not really my little sister, but I consider her my little sister. I grew up with her and I watched her go through life, and I saw her go through the same struggles as me, kind of. She also went to a predominantly white school, and she would just try to fit in with the norms and everything like that. But every time we had a Filipino gathering or she was at my house just to hang out, she's about like five years younger than me, I would just remind her to appreciate the culture that we have. One of the big things we have is my family has an annual Christmas party, and this may sound like a small thing, but every year I would drag her out to line dance with me. And she would be like, no, that's weird, I don't wanna do that. And I'm like, no, come on. And I could see throughout the years, she would enjoy it more and more and more. And she would come to appreciate the culture that she has, even though, like, I saw myself in her, and I didn't want her to think that she was excluded from other people. So through small things like encouraging her to line dance with me, just having simple Filipino gatherings at the home, eating the food, sharing the culture, I was able to see her grow up in a way that I sort of wanted to be able to, with the guidance of someone else who wasn't a direct family member. Like, I wanted to see someone else in my life try to bring the culture in me, and I believe that throughout the years she has taken that impact, because now, even though she sometimes is still hesitant, she's always ready to go to line dance, to eat all the Filipino food, and I see her when she brings her friends to the Filipino parties who aren't Filipino. She's like, try this, try that, this is great. And I really just loved watching her sort of flourish in that way. And I believe I did make an impact on her life. I made sure that she didn't lose touch with her culture, and that sort of, like, I was a guidance to her. Thank you.
Finally, we have Miss India. Would you like the question to be repeated?
All right, sounds good. One of the things you all mentioned, oh wait, Kenny's still sitting up. Okay. I'm sorry. One of the things you all mentioned is the pride that you feel from your individual culture. As someone who believes in representation themselves, can you give me an example of a direct impact that you have had? And if you can, recognize a life that you have changed. Good.
So when I was younger, my family has always been, you know, this grounding source for me, especially when, you know, I did feel out of place as an Indian. They have always grounded me, and one of the ways they did that is they would take me to temple. And one of the things about temple is that, you know, you have this entire community where you're surrounded by Indians no matter how much you, you know, don't fit in with the crowd or whatever. And one thing that I actually really started to do was teach people how to sing. And that was some, and it wasn't just, you know, like, it was Indian classical training that I would do for them. And it was little kids, my class was like four people. And I think singing is such a therapeutic thing for everyone, and especially when it helps. Because I know for me, singing is always something that has, you know, also grounded me and helped me connect with my culture. So for me to do that with little kids who, you know, are like 4 or 5 and they learn very fast, that's something that I took a lot of pride in. And some of them still sing. They're like 8 now or something, but they still sing, and it's so nice to see them, and we'll go up to cultural events. I'm actually going to one tomorrow, and I know some of them are going to sing there. It's so nice to see people who you've taught like that to have this pride that they can sing a Hindi song or Bengali song or any kind of, you know, like cultural song, and how that grounds them to the culture. So, yeah. Thank you, judges, for your questions, and thank you to the top 3 contestants. Good luck.
All right, as we give time to the judges to choose the next Miss Asia, we're going to be moving to our last mini game. So for this mini game, I'm going to call Brianna to the stage, and she'll explain the game.
It involves a snack. You're hungry. So we're gonna need 4 pears. So grab a friend and raise your hand first. No, sit down, boy. Raise your hand first. Raise your hand.
I need 4 people in this circle. They're probably gonna be
the 2 girls. Chocolate donut. No one's allergic to like any of that, right? Okay. So I'm going to ask the people sitting in the chair, please keep your back against the chair to make it a fair game. Don't lean forward and grab the donut with your mouth. So you gotta communicate with the person behind you. All right, Kevin is handing out our donut sticks. We're not starting yet. If you feel a stick touch you, that's Kevin giving you the donut. He might...
Warm round of applause.
Okay, so first we'll be announcing the first three categories, which are Miss Crowd Favorite, Miss Social Media, and Miss Halloween.
So, for our first category, Miss Crowd Favorite, can I get a drum roll, please? Our crowd favorite, Miss Crowd Favorite is Miss Philippines.
All right, next up, Miss Social Media. All right, and the winner of Miss Asia 2019's Miss Social Media is somebody. Miss Myanmar. Miss Asia 2019 is going to be revealed by Christina Tran, our president.
Senior, this is my second year being president, so this is my
like words can't describe how much I love you. So I just want to thank you guys so much. Alright. Thank you guys for coming. Please put your garbage in the trash. Thank you to the Brothers of Delta. That's fun.